So, welcome. Thank you very much to having invited me to talk about our map. And I feel very honored actually to be here. So I think this session was called OSM Base Map. So it's intended for people who want to start or are involved in creating base maps for OSM data. And the intention of the talk now is to show you one example of a map that you could be inspired from, or you can actually use the code from also, because it's also open and it's in a schema that is very close to OSM or is OSM based. My name is Dominik Käufele. I'm the deputy head of cartography at SwissTopo. Sebastian Denier, he is actually our chief vector tiling cartographer, I could call him. And he's unfortunately not here today. Otherwise, he would have done the talk. He's the real specialist in all the details. I was the project manager from the cartography side for our project there. And David Oesch, he's the guy in charge with the federal geodata infrastructure of Switzerland. So questions around the back end, around cloud computing and all is can be asked to him. I'll give you all the emails in the end. So if you have afterwards questions, you can contact these people directly also if you want to. So I have to find the right. Let's start with Switzerland. You may know that Switzerland is a very small country. It's located in the middle of Europe. And as you see here, this is Schweiz. The official name of Switzerland is Schweiz or Swiss or Switzerland, because we have four official languages, and it's obviously not English, as you may hear. And there's a lot of things we're good at. Some I won't mention the other things, of course. One thing is quality. One thing is our nature. We have a terrific nature. We have high mountains. The highest is around 15,000 feet, and beautiful landscape. And we have a long tradition in cartography. This was actually initiated by the French emperor called Napoleon. And he invaded our country in a very small period, about 250 years ago. And he brought all his engineers to measure out the country. And it was kind of the starting point of measuring out Switzerland and mapping Switzerland. I'm situated around here in a small city called Bern. And that originates, the name originates from the word bear. So I'm in the city of bears, and that is our capital. And I'm living in the capital because I work for the Federal Office of Topography, SwissTopo. So I'm from a national mapping agency, and we say we are Switzerland's geoinformation center. Not comparable with, well, in a way comparable to USGS, but a very different organization. But anyway, I don't want to bore you with our organization. Just one thing that is interesting in this context, we have decided to become to switch to an open geo-governmental data strategy very recently. This is new to us. It's this is standard to OSM people, I know, but it's a big change for us. So instead of charging a lot of money for most of our data, we now the standard is not to charge anything and give the data open. There's a couple of exceptions, of course, but now the standard is the other way around. Took quite a long time to get there. We wanted that. I think it's great. I think it's a great strategy, and it's the right path forward. And as a coincidence, on just the same moment, we released our vector tile service, which is integrated in the federal geodata infrastructure, with two new base maps. One is called Light Base Map, and the other called the Imagery Base Map. And the Light Base Map, that is actually an historic thing for us, because it's the first map which has a worldwide coverage. So we have our SwissTopo data, but we have also a map that doesn't stop at the border or a couple of kilometers or some stretch outside the country, but is integrated in a worldwide data set. And the connection to this speech is that we chose for the worldwide data, we chose OSM data and integrated in a worldwide OSM data set. But the Swiss data is the Swiss topo data. So the best thing to look at these things, or the best way, is to look at the products or at the map itself. Take out your mobile phones, because it's much cooler, I think, this vector tiles technology to look at your mobile phone. I can also copy the links in the chat. Where is the chat? Chat. Here, wire. Check. So now you have two links in the chat where you can access the website also. And have a stroll around it. Look with one eye on your mobile phone and one with the other eye on the presentation, however you want to follow now. But it gives you a chance to have a look around while I talk to you. And I'll continue now with a couple of basic stuff about technology. I have no clue who is sitting here, so maybe it's too basic, maybe it's not basic enough. No, I just try to make a good intro. So the first question, of course, is what is vector tiles at all? And I think explaining vector tiles is easiest by explaining raster tiles first. And in raster tiles, you have your data in some databases that's here shown on the left side. And usually you create your map in some kind of GIS system. Or so you have the data and the styling together on your databases side. And then you push some kind of export button, export by TIFF or other image formats. And you have to do that automated way to create all the tiles for all your area in all zoom levels. And the tiles, it is tiled up so you can easier transport it over the internet. So that's the reason these technologies are tiling technologies. So if a client wants to access the map, he goes to the server and requests these pre-configured or pre-rendered tiles of images. But it's static images. And for each zoom level and all the layers, images have to be calculated. Now, raster tiling is very similar. And the only difference is that you don't create rasters already here, but you create tile up your vector data in a special tile set format that includes all zoom levels and everything. It's one tile technology that enables you to create this in one step. And the geometry in there is clipped, and the attributes are split up and duplicated in this format. And you add on one style or several styles, so you don't have to bring in, you don't need several tile sets for several maps, but you can create several maps from the same tile set just by creating several styles. And then you can, from the client, you access a map by asking a style, and the style knows which data to take and delivers both of it to the client. And then the great thing about it is that you have the vectors and the styling on the client side. And it requires HTML5, and HTTP. And with JavaScript, it's very easy to access this dynamically. So it opens a whole new world to change on alter the data and the map on the fly. And I really like it. So this is a new world also to us, because we were used to make static maps. We chose to use Mapbox vector tiles as a standard technology and format. And we chose to use the WebMercator. The WebMercator as a standard because of the worldwide coverage, and our own projection in Switzerland is not suitable. It's not really suitable for worldwide coverage. Well, it distorts the world even more than this one. So that's the basic technology. Now, from the point of view of our data in our situation in Switzerland or in Swiss Topo, we have our data behind a big wall, so it's all locked up in the castle. Of course, this is not 100% security, but it's a high security. And the reason is that we want the origin of our data be safe in our organization. So we have to look to bring our data when it's maintained, to bring it out in the cloud. And we do this by pushing it out in a large PostgreSQL database. And this database contains all the products of Swiss Topo that are provided in the web. So it's first pushed here. In the case of Ectotiles, we use FME to pre-configure some stuff in the data. So there's a data transformation from the origin data to the Lightbase map format data, but it's still the Swiss Topo data format. And then there's something called a pipeline. This pipeline is produces now from this data pod, produces the vector tiles, or in the case of the raster tiles, images from this source data. It's all continuous delivery, continuous update. So whenever something is updated here, we have mechanisms that push it out automatically out here, and it's triggered automatically here if we want it. If you want to push it manually, we can do that also. It's a question of configuration. But the idea is always of these pipelines is continuous update. So whenever something changes here, it's immediately, more or less immediately, minus the time for recalculation here. And the access of the client access then these data. And this is all in a Amazon Web Services cloud. Now, this is very interesting piece of technology here, but actually, and Dave could talk to you about an hour about it, but actually you don't have to care at all because you can access the whole map with one URI. Also, it's service-oriented architecture, so it's really easy to use. And if you then open this style.json, you can read all information out of it you need to know. Because this is open source and open free available, this is your resource if you want to have a closer look into the map. On the rendering side, everyone can use this. Any web, any mobile, any app client providing the basic technology, which is actually HTML5 and HTTP, so available on in almost every client technology around. It was important to us to use open source technologies. At the time, Mapbox was open source, and they last year they said, well, it's not anymore from version 2.1 on, but there's now this MapLibre open source project that will further develop the Mapbox technology. And we really hope that the community will push this, and we will also switch to MapLibre probably very soon. So if you use open layers, MapLibre, QGIS, technologies like that, you get along with open source. You're not required to have licenses or anything like that. Vector tiling is also very suitable to make offline solutions because the tile format is very compact and not very heavy. We haven't explored that yet. We're still working on that. Important for you to know if you want to fiddle around with this map, the Swiss data is from Swiss Topo. It's not OSM data. It's a Swiss Topo data, and everything around it is OSM data. So we made a cut a hole out of OSM, which is allowed by the policy. And of course, this is also open. The vector tiles or the vector data is open, but the raster background, we have we had a company calculate a big raster background looking similar to ours, and that is on the license, so this is restricted, this part. But apart from it, all the vector stuff is open to use. The schema is open. You have these two links here to explore our schema. It's very well documented. I want to show you here quickly. This is our schema explorer. We use this to have a look at the schema. This is very handy because you can just scroll over it and explore it like that, but you don't have that, so you have this. And this is the in-depth, in-detail documentation of our schema, and this is created automatically from the schema and is always up to date for that reason. So you also you see the attribute definition, and you see from which zoom levels on they're used in the data for all classes and types in the schema. And the second thing you have, of course, is the open map tiles schema. The schema we decided to use open map tiles because, well, that was an input from the community when we made a test phase, that they for sure want the same schema for the Swiss topo and the OSM data when they use our solution. And the open map tiles schema offers a very good solution for that because it's quite standardized. So our challenge was to push in, smash in our data schema into this without changing it too much. So it's open map tiles, also open, accessible. And now we're ready to look at the light-based map itself. So the light-based map is a backdrop map made as a background for thematic data. So it's a background of thematic maps. Why is that? Or didn't we have that? No, we didn't. We actually didn't. So this was a customer requirement we had for a long time. And but we didn't want it in to do it in a static way. We want to make use of vector tile technology. And the reason is the following. What you see here is not the light-based map. It's a national map. And you see it's a high contrast map with very strong colors, which is made to make all topographic detail easy to read. So the origin of these designs is, of course, from the paper maps. And if you only use that data, you have high contrast because you want to be able to read these maps in a driving tank or at night with a dim torch, stuff like that. And the map design is quite elaborated to provide this functionality. But it's not so good as a backdrop for thematic data. For example, if we overlay this point layer data, do you see it at all? It's hard to see, isn't it? It's a little bit better if we take black and white, or we can make it all gray, but we wanted to have something better. Why is that? Why? Because we have in our FGDI, in our federal geodata infrastructure, we have 800, 900 thematic data sets to overlay. And we wanted an all-purpose background for all these data sets. So there's polygon data, there's point data, there's symbols, there's whatever, all kinds of colors. And if you have ask yourself why the light-based map is so gray, light, pale, that's the reason why it's a backdrop map. Our challenges were put on top performance. The vector tiles technology is very efficient, yes. So if you have small amounts of data, like a couple of layers of data, this is extremely powerful and extremely efficient. Data is transferred, rendered, and displayed in less than split seconds. So there's no problem with transfer. It's like a miracle. It's check, it's there. But if you have larger chunks of data and the base map is such a large chunk of data, then performance, you get a lot of vectors, a lot of points, a lot of geometries, and transferring that is a little bit of drag. So making a base map is performance intensive, and well, you have to have a look at performance. Designing a backdrop for so many different layers, so have one backdrop fits it all strategy. That was interesting work, and we think it's quite a good outcome now. Designing the LBM layers themselves, what I meant with that is the vector tiles technology is scale independent, and styling works totally different than we were used as cartographers to do that. So it's kind of a new world to us, but also very interesting. One thing we wanted to have, we wanted to make the map visually in a way that it can be recognized as Swiss topo style. And with the vectors, it's quite difficult because everybody can change this style, and it shall be changeable. Everyone can do this. So how can do you keep a Swiss topo trademark? And then the last two is the technology we use to transfer the data out in the web, and the worldwide coverage, which was a new issue for us. The last two are not interesting to you because that's just our problem, but it was a big part of the project. So let's start with the backdrop issue. The best is, again, you look at it yourself. Open that link on your mobile phone. I'll paste a link again in the chat. Hang on a second. I hope it's the correct one. So you have the link there, and I'll open it myself too. Where is it? Probably here. So you should see something like this, and you should have a menu on the left, also on the mobile phone. And here I prepared a couple of these layers. You can take in layers here by just typing in their name. Here is the distribution of a neophyte plant in Switzerland. Prunus laurocarosus, whatever. And this is one type of overlay. You're interested in the distribution of this plant. You see red is very high levels, and it's a bad plant because it's not originated in Switzerland. It shouldn't be distributing too far. And the map design now is in a way that the foreground is more important. It's the info you want, but you should, under it, you should always see the background and be able to interpret everything that is there, so you can orient yourself quite well, no matter which data it is. So there's a compromise between using colors in the background and making strong contrasts and stuff like that. We chose, for example, that the text will be black. And in an application, you can now, because this is dynamic, you can use JavaScript code to layer the text layers on top. This is possible. We didn't do it here yet, but this can be done with the technology. You can also switch to other layers here and zoom around a little bit and judge yourself if we were successful with the task. You can also switch here the transparency of the layers. Then you have also kind of interaction here a little bit. Here is this layer we saw beforehand. This is accidents with personal injury. these are raster layers, but we will switch those to vector tiles too. And you see now they're much better readable with the background that we have now. So that was the intention of the map. So it's not a topographic map, it's a backdrop map. So how did we do the Swiss Topo trademark? Again, you have a link. I'll give you also a link in the chat again. So you have that link too. I switch to the map also. Where do I have it? No. Here. You see, I chose as a background, I chose the imagery data. And let's go to our most famous mountain, the Matterhorn. Maybe you have heard of that. There's pictures because it's right on the border of Switzerland, the peak. In the Italian part of the Matterhorn, we don't have data. And we can now switch the visualization between those. So you see the reality. Of course, the sun comes from the south because we're on the north hemisphere. But in the map, we let the sun come from northwest. And you can see the amount of detail that is in this depiction we took from the national map. Now, the important point here is this is a raster layer. We're very sorry, we fiddled around and tried to make more vector out of it, but we didn't succeed. So we burned all of this in a raster layer. We have kind of skin of the earth concept here. And if we go down here, you see how much detail is in there. That is, there's a hill shine, the yellow. You see, it's not just gray. It's where the sun shines on it, it's yellow. And the gray is more blue, so light and shadow. And where it's yellow, you see that there's actually vegetation because we mask out where there's scree and rock and so, and there the background is white. So we have quite a lot of detail in there. And these nice structures here that are, although they have not much contrast, they are visible very well. This is hand-drawn cartography and gives us a lot of information. So for your interest, we have a background in the backdrop map, and designing a map starts with the background because this influences very much what colors and transparencies you use in the map that you have in the foreground. In there, there's a hillshade, a hillshine, rocks, scree, and glacier drawings. That's it. The contour lines, those are in the vector tiles. So let's have a look at the LBM design, so the vector tile design. Those of you familiar with vector tiles, this will not be too interesting, but for those new to it, this might be interesting. I'm going to show you this with the, where is it here? With the editor we use. Actually, this editor is from the company MapTiler, but you can use Maputnik, which is the open source tool, and this is actually the same here. So it works the same. This is the road, the street where I live. So I'm sitting actually in this house. This is my house. It's part of a row, and I'm sitting here, the living room. And you can always click on any item here on the map, and you see you get to the layer where the definition is in. So here we have obviously a layer chosen to make a layer for the fill and the casing because we want to access it separately. So we have a building. The great thing is that you have a definition in the style from which zoom level to which you want to display it. Already in the data, you had this choice to say in which level do you calculate the data. And if it's there, then you can choose to further restrict it here. There's all kinds of transition functionality, so you can smoothly blend it in and do stuff like that. That's all relatively easy to configure here, or easy to find out. You can add colors. You can change the color in different zoom levels. These are zoom levels here, and do stuff like that. In the end, you get a code. You see a JSON code, and that's the whole code to display the fill of a building. And the only thing we have done dynamically here is change the fill color, change the color a little bit, and change the opacity of the color a little bit. There's trying around. And we have a casing where that is a bit more complex, where you change the color and the line width and the opacity. Whatever you do here, you have a lot of options. This is cartographer's heaven. The technology is really, you have a lot of functionality to do extra fiddling around. And the great thing is it always is directly visible in the viewer, and you can always directly access the map without waiting to export anything or so. So for development, this is really, 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 really nice. Maybe we go have a look at one or two specialties. So we found solution for almost everything that bothered us, or at least not a problem of the styling engine. Let's go to Matterhorn again. So let's have a look how this style of mountaintop text placing is done. This is in the layer peaks rank. And again, we have, we say from which layer to which layer it appears. We have, of course, settings like the font itself. And then there's this the size. And sorry, the sun is shining on my screen. I can't read it well. Here, this field. This does the formatting, which defines that that this text is first placed the name, gets from the name field in the type Latin, add a break, get the elevation from the elevation field, and format it in scale it down to three quarters of the size. That's it. And then you have stuff to tell them where to place this. This is dynamic placing, which is, can go down. You see, there's a little bit more JSON code now in this layer. It's a bit more complex. And this adds up to all the layers. Now, the what we made extensive use is of expressions. Expressions is a technology that that allows you to read from different fields or information from different layers. And this allows you to make much less layers that you would need without it. Without this technology, you need a couple of hundreds layers to make a base map. And with expressions, you need a couple of dozen. And that's a whole different thing. So, yeah. I don't go into detail with this, but you see that things like curved text can you find a solution. Here you need to pre-calculate data. So this can't be done by the styling itself, but it can be done. All you will need if you work with that is really you need the style JSON and then Maputnik. There's nothing else to play around with the style. Very simple. And you can do that from any device. No licensing, no money, just pure joy. So from a cartographic point of view, the summary is the updating, so this continuous delivery, it's much faster and more direct than the raster tiling world. Instead of updating, it would take months or many hours in the infrastructure from updating our map in the traditional way. These master tiles, because all levels are calculated at the same time, it is reduced to hours or even minutes. We have a great flexibility in the map design and the contents, as I tried to show you. This is a technology made for mobile. It's much cooler on the mobile, but of course you can use it in the web too. There's a lot of interactivity possible. I didn't show this. You need to dig into JavaScript for that, and we will explore it. We haven't just brought it into our national map viewer, so the map.geoadmin.ch it's called. That's our portal viewer, and we have to integrate it still there, but there's a lot of possibilities, and we will explore what we want to use for that. The technologies are relatively cheap that we have had to use, and the great thing is the format is really compact. So all of Switzerland fits in half a gigabyte of data without the rasters. There's backdraws in every technologies. This one is not so suited for gradients. There you have to switch to 3D tiling. That's not what we used. We used the Mapbox 2D stuff. In the smaller zoom levels, the medium zoom levels are the most difficult ones, because there you have to acquire a lot of data, and there you need generalization to make it legible. And those don't match the quality of the national maps yet. So we have further project to work on that issue, but we now solve the problem by filtering out information, and that's not always the preferable way. It's okay for this use case with the backdrop map, but if you want to have a topographic map, this should be better. And the technology is not really done for high quality printing. But there's also solutions for that. And I'm sure in the future we'll go more in the direction to explore the possibilities there as soon as these technologies have really arrived in praxis. One thing now, if you use that, it's free and open, and we're really happy if you use it. But as yourself, you're happy with your work, we are also happy with our work. So we kindly ask you to take or give credits by mentioning SwissTopo if you just copy and paste. Of course, if you just take out a little thing, don't worry about it. So you have all the info pages here listed again. Because it's recorded, you will find it later on. And I think Maggie will also put the presentation somewhere on the wiki. The most important site is this one. From this one, you will find all the technical information you require. We're open that you contact us any times. For questions concerning the LBIM or the federal geodata infrastructure. I saw that Dave is now here, so you can also ask him about this stuff directly. And so I think that's it from my side, and I'm open and look forward to the discussion.